Good morning, everyone. It's good to be with you again in this hot morning for me since I'm outside, but hopefully you are inside and staying cool right now. That was a beautiful piece of music by Max Copeland. If you don't know Max, he's the son of Charlie and Lisa Copeland and of course grew up at Crossroads. And so he shared that music with us and we're thrilled to have it for worship. This morning, we continue our two-month series called Justice, Are We Committed? And today, we're going to talk about a kind of confusing passage, which Paul doesn't make a lot of sense on the first read, which sometimes happens with Paul. But I hope that the passage invites us to think about our own actions, about our own indifference, about our own desire to do good and failure to always do so, And so there'll be some videos in worship to invite you to think about what it means to be indifferent in community and what it means to care for others. We've also got a new video with original music written and performed by our own Madeline Gengelbach. So we're excited to share that with you. And some other things in worship that will just invite you to think about yourself and to take a deeper look. And how are we living in anti-racist ways in this time? So we're going to move forward with worship in just a moment. But I want to remind you that when the offertory comes, we are continuing to take up a special collection for More Squared, the Metro Organization for Racial and Economic Equity. And they are doing a lot in Kansas City on the Missouri side and the Kansas side to change policy, to move things forward. And a piece of that is having funds to have staffing to make it happen. So I invite you to join me in giving to More Squared additionally in July or August and helping support the work that they do. And you can do that in the same ways that you give directly to our church, just by indicating that it's for More Squared. So we're going to start off with a video, actually, by a man named James Allison. And Allison is a Catholic theologian, originally born and raised in England, but has spent a lot of his time ministering in various parts of South America and in Spain, as well as a few other. And we're going to actually jump into the middle of an interview with him, in which he is talking directly about indifference and the role that that plays in the community and our connectedness to one another. So take a listen, and then we'll continue with some singing.
Like, why didn't God create us so that we were, I guess, walked into creation sooner or something? I'm thinking, I'm from Houston, and it's like, either need like a hurricane or an eclipse, some beauty or some death or something like that to bring neighbors together with a place that has a church on every corner.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, you're right. And that's one of the strange ways that we've developed as humans, is that we used to live in, how would you say, very close forms of sociality in which belonging and togetherness was very strong, but so also was hostility and vengeance towards outsiders. And now we've got to a space where the belonging and the togetherness are much looser, and the real risk is indifference to outsiders, so that the modern form of victimization is indifference. And I think that that's what we really have to work on. You know, it's good that we've been set free from hot forms of togetherness, because they are infernal. But one of the consequences is what St. Matthew's Gospel said it would be, love grown cold. And we have to learn intentionally how to avoid indifference. And that's a tough one. Because the whole point of indifference is that we don't see ourselves being different.
So what breaks through? Mm.
I mean,
put your head in the cupboard and
break. Well, you know, I think that luckily we do find lots of people engaged in different forms of responding to things, and it's actually learning what's going on is a good part of it. We can all see the big noises, and often enough we're fascinated by the big noises because they're a hell of a show. And even if it's a disastrous show, like the current political scenario, and because of that we're not so good at seeing the tendrils perking up under the permafrost, but it's there. there.
this morning with my mind, and it was stayed on Jesus. I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stayed on Jesus. I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Stayed on Jesus.
No, you can't hate your neighbor in your mind
if you keep it stayed on Jesus.
Can't hate your neighbor in your mind
if you keep it stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Walking and talking with my mind,
and it is stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I'm working for justice in my mind,
it is stayed on Jesus.
Lord, I'm working for justice in my mind,
it is stayed on Jesus.
I'm looking for justice in my mind,
it is stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I woke up this morning with my mind,
and it is stayed on Jesus.
Up this morning with my mind,
and it is stayed on Jesus.
Lord, I woke up this morning with my mind,
and it is stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Say hallelujah.
From Romans 7, 15 through 20. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Keep an open heart each day.
no justice, there's no peace for me. Everything must change. Everything must change. Resisting hardness, embracing kindness and generosity ignites humility.
Well, thank you, Madeline, for that song and your video, and just astounding in so many ways. All of those photos were from protests across the country and even around the world. So something to sit with, for sure. So it's time for children's time, but I have a bit of a surprise, because I know the screen before told you it was Rob, but now Rob looks like someone else.
Poof, it's magic. I am Rob Hatem, very cleverly disguised as Greg Maupins. And I just want to say good morning to all those smiling faces. I know that you can see me and I can't see you. So I'm going to ask all the grown folks to close your eyes and picture the stage up front and picture this parade of kids coming down to join me. We've got Shiloh and Finn, who are usually first. They're kind of grown up, so they're maybe usually waiting to see what happens. Eleanor and Asher are with us. Kathy's got Kai in her arms, and he's down with us. And then the Wilsons are here. So we've got Elise and Elias and Adelaide and Evie. So good morning to all of your faces. I'm trying to get the weird sun off of me because my forehead shines. So you don't notice that. So I want to talk to you today about what we've adults have been talking about in church, and that's a thing called commitment. For some of you younger ones, you might not recognize that word. It might be a big word for you. You may have never heard it before. But some of you older guys, kids, might be more familiar with it. And so things that people are committed to. There's people, to me, what commitment means is that you're promising to be loyal and to be available. So I am committed. I'm a committed Royals fan. And I know that because before the Royals won the World Series and everybody knew who they were, I was still watching and going to baseball games with them. Stephanie is a committed Cubs fan. Finn, you would understand what that means, because she follows the Cubs even when they're not winning. I'm a committed Chiefs fan, and a lot of folks here are. And so before the Chiefs won the Super Bowl, they had some seasons that they weren't really very good, and yet we watched anyway. People are committed to relationships. So people get married, and they commit to share their lives and to share their livelihood and with each other, to take care of each other. People are committed to relationships, to friendships. You might at some point have a really, really good friend that you commit to being friends with. And when you do that, it's a commitment. And you're saying to that person that if you need me, I'm going to be there. And if you need help, I'm going to help you. A lot of folks here today are showing that they're committed to Crossroads and to their church. And a lot of people are committed to their faith. And that means that even when we can't meet together, and we can't see each other and hug each other and shake hands and sing together and be in the same room, that we're committed to sharing time and sharing our faith, and we're committed to fellowship with each other. We're committed to remain in contact with each other, to share our gifts and to support the church even when we can't be there. And not just Crossroads. There are a lot of people that have committed to their churches and are meeting just like we are today, on a screen, instead of together, but that won't last forever. And our commitment is that when we can, that we'll come back together. So what we are talking about for services and sermons has been commitment to change. And if you think about all of these other commitments that we just talked about, what would that look like? And normally I would pass the mic around and you would give me some answers. And so I'm going to assume that your answers would be stuff like not giving up on making change, on continuing to stand with people as they work for change, continuing to pray that change happens, and to doing your part to make sure that change comes about. Wow, those are some great answers. You guys are amazing. You never cease to amaze me. So I just want you to know that we are committed to you. Crossroads Church is committed to you, to making sure that you have a safe place to be, both physically and emotionally, that you have people that you can count on, that you can lean on if you're scared, if you have questions, not just your parents, but people that you can talk to and that you can trust. We're committed to make that happen for you, because you are the future that will make change happen for us. So we love you a lot. Enjoy your Sunday.
Drive out.
place. Only God can. Only light can.
They cannot drive out hate. Tell every child, woman and man.
Only love can drive out hate. Only love can. Only love can. We must be the change we want.
About 21 and a half years ago, Terry and I and some other crazy people decided to invest in an exciting version of church that we now call Crossroads. It was scary, exciting, but we felt with our belief in Jesus and our passion for inclusivity and justice, it would be worth the investment of our souls, our minds, and our resources. That dream has become more than I personally ever hoped for. I have gotten dividends over and over. Then about in 2005, our church went together with some other crazy churches of all kinds, even a synagogue, and decided to invest our souls, minds, and into an organization called More Square, or the Metropolitan Organization for Racial and Economic Equity. That dream has paid dividends for just on both sides of the state line, for education, transportation, and being together and working smartly through politics has made a huge difference. My, what dividends that has created. So I invite you this morning to invest both in Crossroads and More Square. We and they don't just talk justice. We put boots on the ground to make justice happen. And we believe strongly that it is the mission of being a believer of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Creator God, thank you for blessing Crossroads and More Square with investors, wise leaders, and passion to do your work. It seems they become more and more relevant in our society as crises like the pandemic crisis, the economic crisis, and the health crisis seem to be getting worse this year. Help us, Lord, see the part we can play in your kingdom through our resources. We love you and we ache for justice. Show us how to do it. Empower us individually, as a church, and as the local organization. Amen.
From Romans 7:20 to 25a. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
At the corner of 4th and Walnut, at the center of the shopping district, I was suddenly overwhelmed with the realization that I loved all these people, that they were mine and I theirs, that we could not be alien to one another, even though we were total strangers. It was like waking from a dream of separateness, of spurious self-isolation in a special world. This sense of liberation from an illusory difference was such a relief and such a joy to me that I almost laughed out loud. I have the immense joy of being man, a member of a race in which God Himself became incarnate, as if the sorrows and stupidities of the human condition could overwhelm. Me, now that I realize what we all are. And if only everybody could realize this, but it cannot be explained. There is no way of telling people that they are all walking around shining like the sun. Then it was as if I suddenly saw the secret beauty of their hearts, the depths of their hearts, where neither sin, nor desire, nor self-knowledge can reach the core of the reality, the person that each one is in God's eyes. If only they could all see themselves as they really are. Only we could see each other that way all the time. There would be no more war, no more hatred, no more cruelty, no more greed. But this cannot be seen, only believed and understood by a peculiar gift.
So that video, I don't know how many of you caught the very beginning of it, where there was the title screen. But if you didn't, what you missed was that it said a mystical vision by Thomas Merton. And yet the imagery didn't seem like something Thomas Merton experienced. So in 1958, Thomas Merton had a mystical vision while he was out running errands in downtown Louisville. He was already a monk. In fact, the errands he was running were for the monastery. At this point in his spiritual journey, the concept of holy was disconnected and separate from other people, from the world. But in this moment, something that had been maturing within him became clear. He was connected with every human being. Their lives were woven together into the fabric of the universe. And he couldn't separate from the human body. And he saw those around him through the eyes of God for the beautiful creations they are. And he couldn't continue on in his life disconnected from them. Now there is a marker, a historical marker in Louisville, noting this very ordinary space where something mystical took place, where God spoke to Thomas Merton. Pairing this famous vision of Merton's with the current unrest of our country is really powerful. Merton says it was like waking from a dream of separateness. Some of us are being woken up from that dream. Some of us thought we were awake, but we've discovered that we weren't. Not all the way. Yesterday, I went downtown in KC with three other folks from our congregation, and we stood with mothers and sisters and aunts of six men who were killed by KC and Metro Police. Five of them were Black. One of them was white, but a call had been made about suicidal threats. As a mother, and as a pastor, and as a human being, listening to these women tell the stories of their loved ones who were unarmed, who were walking away, whose mental health was at risk, and whose lives were taken, how could we not have empathy? How could we not have compassion? How could we go on as if our lives are separated, as if they are not intertwined? But then there's the truth, the hard truth of what we want to be, which is anti-racist, of how we want to live, of what we want our lives to speak to, and the reality of how we live, and what we do, and what we say. So some of you have heard me talk about my daughter Eleanor recently, and that this, she has these common phrases that she keeps saying. She likes to sing them when she's playing the guitar, or just goofing around, or she'll like pretend to read a book and say them out loud. And one of the things that she says is, "I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what's wrong with me." Now, I'm not sure where this came from and why the three-year-old keeps saying these things. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what's wrong with me. But it's been her mantra during the pandemic. And every time she says it, I have to stop and think, because there's a lot of truth in it. And I think she sums up the Apostle Paul pretty well. Because what the heck is Paul talking about in the 7th chapter of Romans? I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. And it goes on and on. It's a bit of a tongue twister, I think, for our readers. It's a pretty mind-boggling passage that you have to read through several times, and even then you might not have wrapped your head around it. Paul's words have stumped scholars and preachers for centuries, and they've produced all sorts of theories and ideas on what he means. And perhaps they just needed Eleanor. I don't know what I'm doing. But what can we conclude? We can conclude that Paul was wrestling with himself. He was having an inner conflict that he seems to be trying out on the Roman Christians. I mean, that's hard to believe, right? I mean, we preachers never try out our inner conflicts on the congregation. He had lived by the law for so long as a Pharisee, and now as a follower of the way, as a Christian, as a recipient of God's love and grace, he was trying to sort out what role the law now played in his life. Paul seems to be saying that he knows what is right and good, and yet he doesn't always do it. But if he has been born again into God's graces, freed from sin, well then, where do these actions come from? Paul lands on sin, sin with a big S. Sin as an evil that lurks within all of us. Personally, I get kind of frustrated with Paul. I mean, I get frustrated with Paul a lot, but in this passage, because it feels a bit like he's skirting responsibility, like he's trying to absolve himself of his wrongdoing. As in, I don't know what want to do it, but I keep doing it. And since Jesus has redeemed me, it must just be the evil within me that I have no control over and I'm not responsible for. And Paul wants to be rescued from his waywardness that is caused by this evil that is bigger than him. I have to remember that Paul, like many of us, is still learning and still growing. Just a few chapters before, he speaks of how all have sinned. And I think there we see Paul in a vulnerable moment, trying to work things out, trying to figure out how to live a faithful life when our inclinations sometimes lead us in other directions. And that's a struggle we can all relate to. How many of us can honestly say that we don't struggle to do what is right at times? How many of us can say that we often know what is good, what is better, and what is the right thing to do, and yet, you know, we always do it? And I'm not just talking about eating yet another cookie when we've already had four, and we know that's not the healthy thing to do, although some of us probably do that too, myself included. I think a lot of us want to do what is right. We want to do what is good. We want to be Jesus's hands and feet, Jesus's voice in this world. But we don't always live that way. Last week, I talked a bit about being anti-racist, which is what some of us have been discussing in our weekly book study. So if you weren't with us last week and you aren't in the book study, just a little reminder from how Ibram Kendi defines it. A racist is someone who, quote, is expressing the idea that racial groups, an anti-racist, is someone that is expressing the idea that racial groups are equals and none needs developing and is supporting policy that reduces racial inequity. So an anti-racist supports anti-racist policies and anti-racist ideas. For years, I think many of us have wanted to say, I'm not racist. Or some of us have said, we're colorblind. But Ibram Kendi points out that being non-racist is actually neutral, and that the opposite to being racist is to be anti-racist, to be aggressively against racism. I think part of the waking up for each of us goes something like this. I don't want to be racist, and yet I do racist things. I am party to racist ideas. I am compliant with racist policies and leadership. I am supportive of organizations and businesses with racist ideas, practices, and policies. I am privileged because of racism. Does that sound familiar to you? We have been doing the things we don't want to do, and it is our privilege that enables us to continue living that way. But I don't want to live that way, do you? I don't want to stand inches away from those mothers once again, knowing that I haven't done what I can to dismantle racism, knowing that I haven't been anti-racist in my life. So what do? We have to take a deeper look to live an anti-racist life. We have to stop being in denial about the impact our lives have on the racism of our country. Our acquiescence, our silence, it all speaks volumes and further perpetuates the racism and racist policies of our country. I think I need a sip of water. It's hot on my porch. And I'm tripping on my words. So here are some things, three areas I want to suggest that you look at. Look within yourselves and your circles of community. how do you respond to racist comments and racist jokes when you hear them? Do you point out the racism? What about your own language? Take an implicit bias test or look at yourself and start to see where some of your biases lie. Do you remember when Gerald told us in the interview with him about purse clutching and how women will clutch their purses when they pass a black man? What's your bodily response when you pass a black person on the street or in a store? I had a church member once tell me years ago, I'm not racist in my mind, and yet every time I see a black person on the street, I cross to the other side of the street. There's work there to do. What about when you see a news story about a criminal who is black, someone who has been labeled a criminal? Have you noticed that black criminals are more likely to have photos and their race named in the news than white criminals? How is the media affecting our own racism, perpetuating it? Do you have friends of other skin colors or only of your own? What about work? Is there diversity present? Are black staff kept on? Do you see racist hiring policies and practices? Or what about at your child's school? What is the makeup of their staff and teachers look like? So look at yourself and look at your circles of community and be bold to push back on those things within yourself and around you. The second thing is to consider how you vote and how you hold our leaders accountable. Next week, well, a little over a week, August 4th, is Missouri's vote, it's Kansas's vote, and on Missouri's side is Medicaid expansion. It will give Medicaid to over 200,000 people, a large portion of those who are black and brown skinned, who can't afford healthcare even though they are working. Consider how you vote, especially in a time like this, when you might want to just sit back at home and not go out to the polls. Vote for leaders who push forth anti-racist policy. Educate yourself about the people that you are voting for and encourage others to vote. Get trained to register people to vote. Volunteer to work at the polls or as a driver. Advocate for anti-racist policies and join phone banks. If you say and believe, which I think a lot of us do, that voting is one of the best ways that we can transform our community, then let's do more to get folks there than just getting ourselves there. Put pen to paper, pick up the phone, type an email, and hold our leaders accountable and let them hear your voice in support of anti-racist policy. I know a few of our folks do that regularly. But what would the impact be if more of us were doing it? And then the last one I want to speak up to is, where does your money go? What stores do you buy from? Where do you get your groceries, your books, your clothes? What companies do you have stock in? We often go for whoever has the best perks, the best price, the best shipping options, the best delivery or curbside options. But do a little research. What are some of their practices? What organizations does the business support? What does diversity look like in their staffing, especially at the upper levels? Do they pay their workers fairly? And before you ask, or before you email me or text me later, no, I am not going to give you a list of who to buy from and who not to buy from. I am your pastor, but I am not your parent. And we all need to be doing this work. Not just me, not just the leaders of our book study, not just the leaders of More Squared. Start doing some of the research. Share it with other members of our congregation. Put a thread on Facebook so that folks can chime in with where to shop or where not to shop. I know Amazon is convenient, but spend the extra few dollars on shipping to order your books from a black-owned bookstore. Get your dinner at a Black-owned restaurant. Run your errands at a Black-owned store. Put money into the Black community. This week in Kansas City is Black Restaurant Week. So it's a great time to check out some of those fabulous local restaurants. But don't just do it on Black Restaurant Week. Do it regularly. If you're like us and you pick up food once a week, start by ordering from a Black-owned restaurant every other week. Put your money out into the Black community. Put your money in support of organizations that are making change. Do the research. Do the work. The biggest thing about all of this is that we have to be willing to be engaged. We have to stop being indifferent. We have to stop being a bystander. It was good to stand with three of our members yesterday at the press conference, or Friday at the press conference, actually. But imagine the support those mothers would have felt if 10 of us were there, or 20, or 30. We had an amazing turnout the other month on Pray on Troost, over 30 people. What if we always showed up in those numbers at events working for racial justice? What kind of change could we bring about if we woke up and took action? A lot of us like to say, but I don't know what to do. That's not a good enough excuse. We all have the capability to do something. We struggle as Paul did. We have the privilege to struggle in that way. But let us choose what is good and what is right, what is just. Each week, choose an anti-racist action to take. Before you go to bed tonight, decide what it will be this week. Maybe it's to get someone to the polls with you the following week. Maybe it's to research some of the companies you buy at regularly. Let us not be awakened only to go to sleep again, to turn our eyes away, to live in denial, or to utter the excuse, but I don't know what to do. We're all smart folks, and we have work to do. It's hard, but it's imperative. Enough excuses. Let's put our hands, our feet, our bodies, our wallet, and our voices where we say that our hearts are. Amen.
I bet bet you folks are that kind.
Worship today. In a moment, we will sing our closing song, Lift Every Voice and Sing, as we have been doing throughout this series. Next week, next Sunday, is the first Sunday of the month, and so we will share in communion. So have your bread and your juice ready, or whatever you, what substitutes you use, and we'll share in communion together in worship. Also, let me say that the song that we're about to sing, Lift Every Voice and Sing, we are doing a collaborative video for that, like what we did for Kyrie Eleison, and we need videos of you singing to that song. And so we have sent out links through the church email and put it on our Facebook page, and you can, there are very easy instructions, and there are music tracks that you can use to sing with. And we would love for you to record something and to submit it, and we need those by next Sunday, by August 2nd. So we had a handful of us that did Kyrie, but we would love to have even more for Lift Every Voice and Sing, so that it truly can be all of us lifting our voices. And I'll remind you that I was on the last one, and we know that I don't really sing. So trust our producers, Terry Rayburn, basically on this one, that if you have a voice like me, you will not be the dominant voice on the video, and he will make you sound lovely like everyone else, okay? So don't worry about that, but send in that video. We want to see your faces as you sing. Stand up as you sing, because we stand for that song since it is the Black National Anthem. So let's pray, and then we will sing, and our worship will be closed, but if you are a regular or a visitor, we'd love for you to stay on afterwards as we have time to greet one another post-worship. Let's pray. God of love and justice, may we have the courage to move our feet. May we have the courage to use our hands. May we put our money literally where our mouth is. May we use our voices to create space for Black and Brown voices, and may we stand in solidarity with those. May we stop making excuses, and may our commitment rise to a new level of anti-racist actions, seeking eagerly to transform your beloved creation into just that, a beloved creation, beloved by each one of us. Amen. Let's stand and sing our closing song.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise as high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the roaring sea.
The faith that the dark past has taught us.
Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun, let us march on till victory. True to our God, true.